So what do we do today? First, this is our last session. First, this is our last session of this season. We were fortunate to have each other from November until now to go through these times together, to explore the sutras and to find maybe the path or the realizations or some insights from the old scriptures.
We're very fortunate to have you.
And you are very fortunate to have
well.
me. Continue. I really feel very grateful to have this sangha, especially during horrible times. I think it's extremely precious every day, especially in such times. And what we were planning to do this session was another review, a little review of the Shamatha retreat, but to focus on a topic. I will show you the context, where does it fit in Shamatha, but this is something, it's a topic that stands alone. How do we keep enthusiasm in our practice? How do we keep joy and enthusiasm, enthusiastic mind in this practice? Because we need to sustain the practice for long. And maybe now there is a little summer break, so maybe each one needs to hold this practice a bit more solitary way. And the stress factors around that maybe can pull us more into daily worries and we can neglect the practice. So I was thinking that it's nice to finish the season. We're talking about enthusiasm and joy when it comes from Shamatha anyway, that this is the topic we're doing. So I will share the screen, and I'm telling the Zoomies, remember that I don't see you when I share the screen. So if you have a question or something, just immediately say, don't do the little hands or anything, just unmute yourself and tell me, because otherwise I'm not aware of your needs. יש להם את היד הקטנה, לא? Okay. So we are talking about Shamatha. I'm just going to review what I said 2 weeks ago, just for the perspective. So we know Shamatha in English, Calm Abiding. In Hebrew, Shehiya Beshalva. In Tibetan, Shine. We have many words for the same idea. It's a specific level of concentration. Why do I say specific? Because it has specific characteristics. And there is some training before to get it. So I put here on the screen a chart of many, many levels of concentration. So you see that Calm Abiding is only one of them. So we know the context. We know that it's not the only level of concentration and it's only one or zero. Either I have it or I have nothing. Because I can be on the path, I can still have some levels of concentration, even if it's not fully qualified Calm Abiding. So I have, as you see, we read this chart from down up. So you see the first one that is in black, it's the 9 mental abidings. It's 9 levels that I practice until I reach Calm Abiding. Calm Abiding is the first one on the purple. So I can be on each one of these 9. So even if I don't have Calm Abiding, but I can still hold some concentration. We all have some concentration in our daily life. This is the mental factor we cultivate in order to reach Calm Abiding. Why do we focus specifically on Calm Abiding if there are so many levels of concentration? Because this mind is strong enough to put on top of it the strong wisdom that is called special insight. And with this, we can have the realization of emptiness. Okay? Calm Abiding is strong enough that if I put on top of it bodhicitta, I can never lose it. But if I don't have Calm Abiding as a base, I can have glimpses of bodhicitta, but it can be lost. So Calm Abiding is like such a strong mind. It's like the basis that on top of it, I can put many other minds that are very strong. I can put renunciation on top of it, bodhicitta on top of it, special insight on top of it. Once you have Calm Abiding, the mind is so strong that everything you do is more powerful. every positive action, every virtuous action is much more stronger. The effect is much stronger. The merit that you accumulate is by far stronger.
Special insight is wisdom. What is special insight?
Special insight, you see it on
analyzing meditation, analytical meditation.
Yeah. Special insight is reached with analytical meditation. It's a type of wisdom. It's a wisdom that is a analytical wisdom that is characterized with specific features like calm abiding. You have double pliancy and bliss also for that coming from special insight, and this is strong enough to penetrate the nature of reality. And they put it here because this is also a tool to progress on.
Can I ask something?
Yes.
Calm, even if I'm not sitting on the cushion, is it something that I take with me, or just when I sit and...
That's a good question.
Because the special insight is this really sharp realization, and that's it, you're anywhere.
Special insight is a mind, it's not necessarily a realization, but I think all the realization based, you know, yes, good. That's why you do it, yeah. Right? Yogic direct perceiver, it's a type of mind, that right. The uncommon empowering condition for it, it's the union of karma and special insight, right?
Right.
So it's a mind that holds the realization and doesn't. If it's outside, it doesn't lose it in this life. Different lives, I don't know. Definitely not all the things. If we have it outside of the cushion, I had once discussion with Francois about it. I don't know. I never heard teachers. He said that you can keep it outside of sessions. My knowledge is limited. So just to show you the features, the definition of what is calm abiding, we did it last time, I just review now. You can abide on the object single pointedly. You don't need to analyze. The mind just stays on the object, zero effort, not tiny bit of effort, as long as you want. Staying on the object means no distractions, not even the very subtle ones. Nothing takes you away. Nothing makes the object disappear. Nothing makes the object fade away. Nothing competes with the attention. Suddenly I think of something else, never happens. The mind is so serviceable. Whatever you want to achieve, you can do with the mind. It's like totally like plastilina that you worked with so much that is so, is just giving you whatever you want. Abiding on the object, single-pointedly, no effort, as long as you want. As long as you want can be weeks. This is the measure of calm abiding. And they give more features for the definition of calm abiding. It's a combination of two features. One is stability. Stability means no distraction. I don't leave the object. Stability. I put here also relaxation. It means that relaxation is the feature that helps us not to lose the object. Because when we are a bit tight, we think that if I hold this stronger, I can never lose it. The stronger I hold, it's mine. But with the mind, it's opposite. The stronger I hold, there is some tension in the mind, it's easier. Opposite of the physical things. So stability goes with some relaxation. For example, when we practiced and we said only part of the object appears and it's fine, and you practice acceptance and relaxation, this is supporting stability. And the other feature that is unique for calm abiding is this clarity, vividness. When I hold the object, it's not a very dark mind. It's not a very bored mind. It's not something vague. It's very intense, very vivid, very alive. The object is just shiny. There's some intensity there. Okay? During the practice, these 9 levels to practice up to calm abiding, we usually practice them separately. Either we work on stability in the beginning, and when it's strong enough, then we add clarity. And at first, sometimes they take more power over each other. Like if I do more stability, I have less clarity, and the opposite. At the end, they unite. And then with one mind, I have both. With Kama Abiding, you have both. It's not like during the nine levels, you focus more on this or more on that. But at the end, when you're in Kama Abiding, you are stable and clear. Right? We do them both. And the definition even says, how do you get there?
Kama Abiding.
We work on it. We work on it.
Kama Abiding.
This is a demonstration of our mind when we cannot meditate. We have the preliminaries. We have nine steps to reach Kama Abiding. And we have skillful means, huh? And we have physical and mental pliancy and bliss. Physical and mental pliancy and bliss means physical, means the body is fully serviceable for me. I don't have knee pain, I don't have back pain, I don't need to eat, nothing in the body can distract me from abiding on the object as much as I want, as long as I want. The body is fully serviceable, the mind is fully serviceable. הוא כאילו נענה לך, הוא שימושי לך בצורה כזאת שאין שום מגבלה. פליינסי זה מין מילה שאני לא יודעת לתרגם אותה, אומרים גמישות, כן, אבל זה לא גמישות של אולימפיאדה. זה כאילו הוא נענה לכל מה שתרצי, הוא לא מציב שום מגבלה, שום מכשול. The body is like very light, because now we have a very coarse body. We see 2 minutes, so that's the watch, how do I look when I stand up after this session, the knees don't stretch and... heavy coarse body, but when you reach Kama Abiding, there's some lightness in the body. It's like a body of light. It doesn't give you any burden. It's like, it's not a burden anymore. And the mind is the same. Nothing competes with me staying on the object. Nothing can distract me. Nothing can take my attention away. So everything you need, body and mind, are just at your service on 100%. Okay, so this is the description of Kama Abiding. And we said that the text presents 2 ways of how to reach this level. Either by the 9 levels of Kama Abiding, 9 mental abidings, or by the 5 faults and 8 antidotes. François in the retreat didn't elaborate on the 9 levels because it was too short. This is what we will do on the retreat in March. He's coming back in March. So we'll have another 5 days retreat with him. He started with the 5 faults and 8 antidotes. Now I want to emphasize something. It's like His Holiness says, you can use Buddhist tools without being a Buddhist. You can use tools for improving concentration, even if we don't work on shamatha. Like last time we did mindfulness and introspection. Even if I don't work on shamatha, mindfulness and introspection can be very useful tools for me for whatever practice I have. If I have a sadhana, if I do mahamudra, if I do whatever object I need to hold on in my mind, mindfulness and introspection are needed. So everything we learn from within this technique of shamatha is useful for us, whatever we do now, okay? So last time we did the 5 faults and 8 antidotes, we focused on mindfulness and introspection, and today we'll do enthusiasm and joy, which are still from this technique. I just remind you this 9 steps. How come you don't have what I see?
Oh, I did that.
It's fine.
Steps delay.
It takes time.
Oh, yes, delay.
Yeah. So the 9 steps, we saw the little movie last time. I just gonna review it in a second. I always find this little movie or this little diagram, very touching, because you start, the elephant is the mind, you start with running after your mind. You see the monkey is just running after the elephant, and the elephant is almost two steps ahead. And the elephant is running after the monkey is the distraction. And I think everybody that starts to practice, we know this experience. We try to do something and the mind is setting up his own goals, his own things. And I'm just running after that, trying to understand what's going on. Where did I go? When did I go? How do I bring it back? And this is how we start. But during these steps, there is a gradual process of being less and less away from the object, more and more on the object. We strengthen mindfulness. This is what we talked last time. You see the fire along the little steps. It's the fire of effort. In the beginning, we put a lot of effort. But at stage number four, mindfulness is maturing enough, we'd never lose the object anymore. We can have sometimes, we say, subtle distraction, that I have the object, but I have some thoughts at the same time. But this stays for quite a long time, until number eight. Then you have on the steps of five and six, you mature introspection. So you know how to work with your distractions. And then seven and eight, you mature joyous effort in such a level that on number eight, you have tiny bit more effort. But in number nine, the step number nine, no more effort. And then number nine is when the elephant is up there and is fully white. This is zero effort. Then there is a little path that he still walks. And this is when you have double pliancy and bliss. They arise after no more effort. And when he sits in the cave, he has come back. And just to see this transformation is so inspiring. Because we all start with a dark, distracted mind that sets up my path. But I can end up in a very different point. Even if I don't end up in calm abiding, but I progress on the path. Because the mind is empty and we can transform, we can improve, we can develop many or cultivate many qualities. So this is really the different steps. When you learn the different steps, it's really like Francois said, like driving your mind. Because all this technique is based on how I identify what happens to me now.
The path.
So it seems. אז אנחנו... אבל הנה, אני רואה אתכם. אתם התנתקתם? איבדתם אותי? לא. אז אולי רק של המחשב ההוא התנתק. רגע, תכף יש לנו בעיה עם המסך פה. הנה, חזר. זה כאילו שני מחשבים שונים, אז אחד נשאר ואחד התנתק?
כן.
אוקיי. So what I was saying, what did I talk about? What happened to
him?
אבל מה יש לי להגיד? מה דיברנו? אצלי לא שם, כדי שלא יהיה דאבל. Okay, so I'll share the screen again. Yes. The thing is that we can cultivate the mind, right? So even if I'm now on level two, and I just work on mindfulness and introspection, that's it. And I progress to number four. It's a huge change. It's a huge change. I jump one or two levels, already the experience in the practice will be totally different. We don't need to say, okay, calm abiding is too far for me, then I don't even start. Do 5 minutes a day of mindfulness and introspection, 2 minutes and a little debriefing, 2 minutes, a little debriefing, that's it. And you will progress. You just need to do it, steady every day, 5 minutes every day. You jump two levels, all your experience in the practice will be different. And this can give some joy and enthusiasm to continue. Otherwise, you say, oh, I never do that. Then you don't feel like sitting. Don't do long sessions. If we now separate for the summer break, and you need to hold on your practice, do 5 minutes a day. Take 1 minute to calm down, set up your motivation, 2 minutes mindfulness, little debriefing, 2 minutes another either mindfulness or introspection, dedication, debriefing, finish. Every day. And you will progress, I hope. You can try. Like one day. So this, just to show the elephant is the consciousness, the rope is mindfulness, and the hook is introspection. And we have the monkey who is distraction, and the rabbit that appears on stage 4, which is laxity. Laxity is a mind, it is a bit dark, it's a bit going down. Not fully sleepiness, can be there, but when you say laxity, sometimes it can be very subtle, but it comes on the expense of this vividness and clarity that we want. As long as you have this laxity, it's very hard to have a very clear and intense mind.
Yael, can I ask something? What is important to see in the debrief? Because you said, you know, the debrief is part of this, let's say, 5 minutes.
Yeah.
So it's important to see and to look at in the
debrief. So last time we gave little practices how to do mindfulness, right? First, we analyze the object very well. So you take 1 minute and a half every session to get to know your object well. In the debriefing, you just say yourself, okay, I use that that consciousness because I heard the sound. I use that consciousness, the eye consciousness, because I saw my chest going up and down. I used my tactile consciousness because I felt the fabric on my belly. I used the mental consciousness, imagining my chest going. So first, get to know your object very well. In the debriefing, you check, what did you really figure out? Then when you practice mindfulness, you can analyze many things. You can analyze the difference in the debriefing, the difference between analyzing and abiding, right? Because we said first step, we analyze. Second step, we take like a step back and we just abide. But to understand this switch between analyzing and abiding, I need to find this little button in my mind. So this is something I can analyze. Can I clearly distinguish between analyzing and abiding? When I am abiding, is the object as clear when I'm analyzing or less? Did a full object appear, or only partial? Did the object change? Sometimes I felt in the belly, sometimes I felt in the nose. Many things I can analyze. And Francois even said, take a little diary. And you can say in tiny little notes, what do you experience? And then you can follow it for a long time. Also with introspection, the snapshots. You take one, you take few, can you do that? How did it work? This is the debriefing you do.
Mm-hmm. Perfect. Thank you.
איך אומרים דיבריפינג באנגלית?
תחקור, פשוט לתחקר את מה שקרה. Okay. Remember, the previous session is recorded, so you can go back to it and review it. And we have the document that everything is written there.
It's on YouTube?
On YouTube.
It's on.
Okay. So now we are going to the technique that I wanted to dedicate this session for. It's the 5 faults and 8 antidotes. 5 problems and 8 pills that can help us deal with them. And the first problem is that we don't feel like practice. We don't feel enthusiasm, we don't feel joy, we don't feel like sitting. Everything else seems very appealing. And sitting and practicing seems very boring, with no aim and no purpose, and tachlit. I prefer to do anything else but this. You know, I really had this state of mind, for example, when I used to study for exams. Suddenly, it's very important to clean the house, to do shopping, do everything but cleaning the house because I hate cleaning. So sometimes you find it with practice as well. You say, yeah, I don't feel like practice. And you prioritize locally. I prioritize everything else. And the text talks a lot about it because this is really what prevents you from sitting. And if you don't sit and practice, you will not improve and then you're out of the practice. And the solution that they offer us is a very interesting one. First, they elaborate a bit, how do you identify your lack of enthusiasm? And they say it can take three directions. One is procrastination, dachyanut. Very important, tomorrow I start. Tomorrow, and then tomorrow, and then tomorrow, and then tomorrow. Mañana. Either we are attracted to daily activities, that we just prioritize them as higher and more important, or lack of belief in myself that I can do that. They call it some like disheartening, like too big, it's not for me. Some people maybe can do concentration. I cannot do anything. I tried a few times. I didn't improve, so I conclude it's not for me. So you say the mind is empty, so everybody's empty, mind is stuck. Cannot do concentration. We have this inner talk so many times. I can write you all my sentences. Now I don't invent anything now. I feel it very strongly. Years. It's like something we all deal with because we tried a few times. I always fall asleep. I cannot see this clarity. I cannot hold the object. I'll do something else. And the text says, no, don't give up. Don't give up. Even if you find it challenging, even if you don't see the fruits you are aiming to, it says, wait. Don't give up so quickly. And he said, let's generate enthusiasm. And like every other thing in Buddhism, if I want something, I need to accumulate the causes, cause and effect. They never say, be happy, be relaxed, be enthusiastic. They say, accumulate the causes, the result will come. There is a sentence of Lama Tsongkhapa says, once all the causes are there, what can prevent the result? What can prevent the effect? I just need to collect all the causes. So they say, we will tell you what are the causes to generate enthusiasm. So before I show you what the text says, what would you say? What can be the causes that if I accumulate them, they can generate enthusiasm in my mind that I'll be happy to practice? What can be the causes for that? The benefits of what?
Practicing or having calmer mind.
So for example, I need to know what is waiting for me. Like if I want to practice for something, what this something can bring me? What are the benefits of concentration? In our context, everything I say is about calm abiding, but you can take it on any quality you want to cultivate. What would be the benefit of more concentration in my life now? Even not fully qualified calm abiding, fully qualified for sure, but even just progressing, what I will benefit from having more concentration? The more you know, the more you put effort. I met a guy that he's really strong into fasting. A lot of research, and he says fasting is the ultimate medicine. It can prevent cancer. Latsum. Oh, חברה שגר. So he's dedicating his life into 40, like bitmen. And he's to himself, if I feel like eating, his inner talk is, if I'm eating now, it will have a day less my life expectancy. Like, אני מקצרת חיי בחצי יום, לא שווה את זה. But these are the benefits. He's working from the benefits, right? He says, the more I fast, because the body doesn't need so much food, he has time to correct all the problems and to prevent sicknesses. And the more I fast, the longer I will live, and I want to live longer with a good quality of life. And he thinks fasting is the way. So each time he has a little weakness or temptation, he goes back to the benefits and says, but I want to live longer. Does it worth half a day less if I have this something? And the text, Lama Tsongkhapa, is really thinking the same way. He says, hold the benefits in your mind all the time. And if you feel the enthusiasm going down, go back to the benefits. Because many times we are forgetting the what is waiting for us, and we're just busy in these 5 days, 5 minutes practice, and sometimes it's boring and I forget what I'm doing. Sometimes we forget the big scale. So we can think of the benefits. What else can we do? If I think of the benefits, then what happens?
Actually, I think it really helped me not thinking of the benefits that I can get, because with that, there is always a problem of belief. It's not like a belief in myself. It's a belief in whether it actually gives such a benefit. Because I'm not sure, I don't know. And it's not like I can see an example of me or someone having this specific benefit. This is a problem with some of these practices, like they're not to be shown. So I don't see examples. So there is always the problem of my critical mind, which is saying that I don't really know whether it will be a benefit or not. So what actually helps me is looking for benefits which I already can get myself, whatever they may be, however small they may be.
Okay.
Yeah. And so this is my own experience, that if I do it, I have some specific effects. I feel better. I feel less stressed for me, for example. Yes. And this is something which is valuable for me. And so this is what actually stimulates me to do it more.
Okay. So I just repeat for the Zoom. Alex says sometimes with the big, big benefits of fully calm abiding, I cannot validate it. For example, one of the benefits of calm abiding is superpowers. They have divine ear, divine eye, divine feet, right? They have wind walkers. And how can I validate it? How do I know if it's true or not? So sometimes you look at the benefits when you are too high and you say, this is a bit based on faith, but I can validate what happens to me when I improve my concentration. Even if I'm far from calm abiding, but I know that as long as I work on concentration, suddenly I feel more relaxed, more peaceful. Suddenly I can see that I can think deeper because I'm not distracted all the time. I can go into depth. I feel my benefits when I improve my concentration. So this gives me enthusiasm to continue and to even strengthen what I have. Even with the list of benefits, some we cannot validate, some are very reasonable. So we can validate with reason as well. And we connect it to our experience, then it gives lots of juice. Okay, so I have these benefits. And then what comes from out of it? Drive. So we call it aspiration. And it's really the drive. I want to have it. This is what motivates me. This is the drive. I want to have it. So you have knowing the benefits. Then you have the aspiration. I want to have this. Then what happens?
You have the drive to do it.
Then I put effort. This is the third factor. If I have really believed that this is good for me and I have a drive, then I'm willing to put this 5 minutes every day or even more. So I prioritize my practice higher and I can put more time. And only if I put time, benefits come. And then if I put more time, then I have the result that the body is serviceable, the mind is serviceable, then I can get the benefits of practice. And this is what they offer. They offer a chain of four factors. This is in the context of calm abiding, but you can put it on compassion, on love, on open heart, on equanimity, on any quality you want to develop. First, faith of conviction. Faith of conviction means in the qualities. Not that I have faith that there is such thing as a Buddha, in the qualities of what I want to grow or cultivate. What are the benefits of love? What are the benefits of equanimity? The first four immeasurable that we did this morning, the first one is equanimity. In an area like us that everybody hates everybody, what will be the benefit of a world that everybody has equanimity, for example? Or attachment, that we care only for the one that are close to us and we hate the others. What would be the benefit of a world without attachment? Just this, just to think, this is faith of conviction, but conviction, I get this level of certainty. And then, yes, there's the drive, then I want to have it. I want to have equanimity in my mind because I see how much I suffer from aversion and attachment. I see the suffering that I experience. I want to have equanimity. And if I want, then I'm willing to put effort. Then there is joyous effort. And from this complexity means I get the mind and the body to be serviceable, then I can get the qualities I want. So now the question.
I have a question.
Yes, you have questions. In Hebrew. And I'll translate, no problem.
If I take all this
can ונרגעת. איך עושים את זה? כן. מיישמים. כן. נכון. נכון.
אבל אני חושב כל הפתים, ומי גם נראה. ואני חפש את זה די צרי.
אבל בתוך התודעה שלי.
כן.
נכון. זה בדיוק זה. Yael is asking, I just do it for Alex. Yael is asking, and for the Zoom maybe. Yael says, in this day when the stress level is quite high and we are just thinking about what happens if there will be an attack and missiles are going to fall on us, how do I apply this chain of four on my situation at the moment so I can calm down? So I can calm down because the stress level is really, really, really climbing up in these days like crazy. And Nurit wanted to say something.
I would say that the more I will practice in this situation, the more I will be in my thoughts, my worries, and have the habits of coming back to what happens now. And now, always, now, okay? Till there is no one, and till you are not, misses. Till you
are not,
misses. Till you are not, misses. את כאן ועכשיו, התרגול הזה של להיות ברגע הזה, הוא מתמקד באובייקט, אז אני יותר יודעת איך לחזור למשהו אחר, מאשר המחשבות המדהיגות שלי. זה משל קורונה.
כן.
סבל,
אנחנו נוראים. So Nurit is offering the perspective of being, bringing the attention to the present moment. The more I practice, the more I'm staying with my breath, breath, the more peacefulness comes, because at the moment there are no missiles. So I'm not in the worries for the future. I'm present now, and now at the moment I can do many things, and many things are open for me, and life is happening now, not from worries in the future. Yeah. For me, I don't see any gap between applying it for everything, including stress for now, because I start with faith of conviction saying, do I believe that I create half of my suffering? At least. So there is the problem of missiles coming. On top of it, my mind is now abusing me in such a way that most of my suffering now is a result of my mind. If I accept this basic principle of Buddhism, and I have faith of conviction that if I work with my mind, I can ease at least half of my suffering, if not more. If I have faith of conviction in this, then I have aspiration to cultivate equanimity, for example, or to cultivate what can I cultivate not to be stressed now? Sorry?
Relaxation,
stability, acceptance of my suffering, of my stress, but acceptance releases a lot of stress. Tonglen is a tool, yeah? Disattachment, non-attachment, for sure. So if I have faith that if I work with my mind, I can ease lots of my stress, then I have a drive, I have the aspiration to practice it, then I put effort on the practices, and we know the practices. The thing is that we study the path, but when there is a big stress coming, we put it aside and we think all the source of the problem is outside. And the Buddhist path is always saying half, at least half of the source of the problems are inside. It's like, you know, that Lama Tsongkhapa opens the Lamrim with a very nice sentence. He says, if you have a horse, and you want, let's say in the Olympic Games, you want him to race for you. So you train him on a specific track. And you want him to know the track so well that you know when there are little bumps, when you take the curve, like the more the horse knows the track, the faster he can go. he can be more skilled. So you train the horse on one track all the time, and on the day of the competition, you take him to a different track. Not wise. And he says, many practitioners do the same. They study the path, but then when they really need mental tools, what should we do now? He said, everything I told you. He says, everything I told you, all the practices of the Lamrim are getting to know the track. You know that you need to look inside, but when there is stress, you look only outside. He says, no, this is the track you learned. Practice to look inside. The more we practice to look inside and we understand the benefits, we have faith of conviction in the benefits, then all this chain just falls out and we are there. We know the practices. We get disoriented when we are stressed. So it's just going back. That's why it starts always with looking inside. Faith of conviction in the qualities of working with our minds.
Because I can understand the everyday work that I see regarding the body and mind, but when I was using it every day, even from the things that you get for the week, and it seems that they are talking about something else, like some, I don't know, medical things. What can you explain
about pliancy? Pliancy.
Yeah.
עוד פעם התנתקתם? אבל זה רק לכם. הזומיז, אתם שם? אתם שומעים ועוקבים?
כן.
כן. יופי.
אבל לא שומעים את הנאמר ברקע, רק אותה.
רק עכשיו את השאלה.
כן, 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 אני מיד חוזרת. אני מיד חוזרת.
כן.
Is a result of all this change.
The result that the best practitioner.
Everything, every quality we cultivate, there is a scale. It's not that I have zero pliancy and then one day, oh, I have 100% of pliancy. I cultivate it gradually. So you and I at the moment have some percentage of pliancy, and the more we cultivate it grows, and the more we cultivate it grows, until it reaches level, very mature level. But it's not that we have zero pliancy. So we need to understand on every quality, like love, like compassion, everything we do, we have smaller levels and we cultivate it. Pliancy means serviceability of body and mind. What does it mean, serviceability? That it doesn't, the question was to explain a bit about pliancy. So pliancy is serviceability of body and mind to the level that we can cultivate the qualities we want. So for example, if I want to cultivate love, full pliancy, I'll have immeasurable love for every sentient being. Less pliancy, then my love will be maybe limited for some people that I like. Less pliancy, I'll have love for people as long as they do what I tell them. Yeah? Like we have different qualities. Pliancy means that your body and mind are totally serviceable for you. You can reach what you want. On the higher level of karma bhakti, because the mind abides on the object with no distraction, there are subtle winds in the body, and the subtle winds they go for perfect alignments, because the subtle winds are the mind rides the subtle winds. They always go together, subtle wind and the mind. It's a tantric explanation, subtle wind. I will not go into deep explanation. In tantric practices, they don't do just cognitive work. They work with the body, but the body, the subtle body. Subtle body means channels, energies, subtle winds, chakras. They don't work just with hands and like limbs or the coarse body. So parts of the practices are moving the winds in the body. There are many winds, like what you call chi when you do acupuncture, or when you do tai chi. So there are subtle winds in the body. According to Tantra, mind and subtle wind, they always go together. If you have karma abiding, or even the ninth level, your mind abides on the object, and there's so much peace in the mind that all the subtle winds in the body, they set in such perfect alignments that the body becomes physically fully serviceable. That's the reason. And then you have a bliss and pliancy. It goes together, the bliss and the pliancy. Yeah. It can be physical and it can be mental. But this is a very high level of serviceability. Even before, we still have pliancy in that level. Right? Don't ever think that any quality you cultivate is either zero or 100%. There's a gradual process. And what I want to emphasize, how are we with the time? What's the time now?
42, I think.
22. Okay, so one thing, and then we'll discuss this part, which is extremely important after the break. When we talk about faith of conviction, we need to strengthen two things. One, the qualities of what I want to cultivate, let's say the qualities of concentration, like we talked. But the other one, I want to have faith of conviction in my capacity to achieve these qualities, to practice. And this is an antidote for this reason of a lack of enthusiasm saying, I cannot do that. Remember when we said lack of enthusiasm, you have either procrastination, attraction for daily activities, or saying, I cannot do that. So here we give the antidote. We say,
yes,
we can. And not just as a mantra, I need to cultivate faith of conviction. Faith of conviction that I can do that. And this is, till now it was just building up so we understand the context and the importance. But if, like, we need to know, like, we now take one tool out of this chain. How do I cultivate faith of conviction in my capacity to practice? If I have this, you will never abandon your practice. On what and how?
Yeah.
On what and how? This will be the discussion. This will be the what I want you, us, to take out of this session. How do I build my faith of conviction in my capacity to practice? You have this, you have enthusiasm, you have all the change. Yes? Yes. So I think one more sentence and the break.
אני יכולה לשאול משהו?
כן.
יש משהו פה שקשור גם לחמלה עצמית בטיפוח של האמונה הזו?
תרחיבי.
כך אני מרגישה.
תגידי עוד משהו.
שככל שנגיד השיפוט או הביקורת העצמית נחלשת, או ככל שיש לי איים פתאומיים שאותם אני מרגישה בזמן האחרון בעקבות התרגול הזה, שפתאום יש אי שבו אני חופשייה מביקורת עצמית, ואני אפילו יכולה להביא פנימה היפוך של חשיבה ביקורתית ולהגיד, לא, זה לא נכון. את ממהרת לשפוט עצמך, ולהפך, יש פה צד נורא חיובי של משהו ש... ואז אני חושבת, זה מאוד מגביר אצלי את
הרצון
לתרגל כל פעם יותר.
נהדר. זה למשל כלי אחד. English. So I repeat in English.
Yeah, I can repeat it, sorry. Well, I find that self-compassion is very, very helpful, and it's also part of my faith and conviction, because whenever I reduce self-judgment, and I also kind of bring in a positive view of what I was suspicious of myself,
yeah,
originally, then I kind of feel a desire to practice again and again.
Yes. So this is really knowing your own buttons and your own mind, because we know that when we start to be very strongly self-judging ourselves, it's not supporting anything. Nothing. Definitely not a practice. So when we know how to identify it and to counteract it with self-compassion, I can take myself out of this loop of I cannot do that because I didn't do in the past, or I cannot succeed in the past. And so this can be definitely a tool. לעוף על עצמנו. אני אגיד משהו בעברית. טוב, לא. חברה אמרה לי שאיך חברה טובה נמדדת. בדיוק, נכון? כמו חזייה טובה, היא תמיד מרימה. ככה היא אמרה. How do I translate? How do you measure a good, like it was a women talk, so how do you measure if another woman is a good friend of yours? She's always rejoicing in your, like a good bro, it's always putting you up. So it's always putting you up, something like this. Last sentence, Buddha makes this connection as well in his sutras. It's not that just we say we need to work on faith of conviction of our capacity to practice. Buddha instruct us this in the sutras. There are many sutras that are dealing with the six recollections. Recollection, something we need to recollect, to think all the time, to remember all the time. The three jewels and their qualities and what is their meaning. One's own generosity and one's own virtue. He says, yes, remember your virtue all the time. Remember your qualities, remember, because this will give you enthusiasm and power to keep on practicing. Buddha instructs us to do that. So we see the chain. I'll put the chain after on the screen again, so in the break you can see the chain. We have the chain. We understand that we, as long as we have antidote for self-deprecation, we can hold on to the practice. And Buddha says, yeah, do you do that? You work on remembering all the time your generosity, but this I put aside, your own virtue. So after the break, we can take now 15 minutes break, and then we can, something in the chat, lifting you up. Thank you. Ah, Varda is here also, nice. So after the break, we can discuss how do we do that? How do we build up enthusiasm and faith of conviction in my capacity to practice? Okay? Let's have
okay, 12.
So 15 minutes, we are going on a break. And then we do discussion group, and then all your Zoomies can do a little discussion of among yourselves. אז אני רק מזכירה שאנחנו כאן. אנחנו כאן על faith of conviction ביכולות שלי לתרגל. ושבסיקס ריקולקשנס, בודה בדיוק תומך בזה, ואומר, תחשבו על הפעולות המיטיבות שעשיתם, כדי לפתח faith of conviction, כדי שתהיה לנו התלהבות להמשיך את זה. אז עכשיו אני שולחת אתכם לעבודה קבוצתית, סביב הדברים האלה. קבוצות קטנות, והזום יזיהו גם קבוצה, תכף נארגן אתכם גם. ואני מציעה... חמש שאלות, אבל אתם יכולים לבחור מתוך זה רק אחת או שתיים, או אם יש לכם משהו אחר להגיד, או... אחד זה למה חשוב לזכור וירצ'ו שעשינו, פעולות מיטיבות. למה חשוב? מה יהיה המחיר אם לא נזכור את זה, אם זה לא יהיה recollected, אם זה לא... למה אני בעברית? Sorry. You didn't tell me, I start automatically, but... So we said now we are on the topic of remembering my own virtue, trying to apply an antidote for lack of enthusiasm saying I cannot practice. We try to cultivate faith of conviction in my capacity to practice, regardless of the qualities of concentration, my capacity to practice. So in small groups, we can discuss, I offer five directions, but you can take it wherever you want. One is, why is it important to remember our own virtue? Good actions we did in the past. What will be the disadvantage of not remembering? Like, what kind of price shall we pay if we don't pay attention to our virtuous actions? What can we rejoice about? The Buddha says, recollect your own virtue. Okay, what do I rejoice about? What kind of action, thoughts, things? What can I rejoice on my, when I look about my past? What can be the obstacles that stop us from rejoicing in our own virtue? and how can I deal with them? Okay, so I will just send them to a room, and then I leave the questions here on the screen, and we can take like I don't know 20 minutes. 20 minutes for that, because then at the end I want to read you a beautiful, beautiful commentary of Thich Nhat Hanh on the Lotus Sutra on these things. So yeah, 2, 3, 4, you decide as you want. Go for the people you know less, then you have more interesting discussions, usually. Do I need to put the Zoomies in a separate room? הנה הילה גם, שלום הילה. אוקיי, so I send you for room and I pause the recording. להגביר אותם? אני על המצמי. Probably you didn't have enough time to discuss all the 5 questions into depth, but I decided, or I thought, to put all the 5 because these are the lines of thinking that you can take with you. We don't have to finish here anything, right? It's not realistic, but these are the lines of topics that you can investigate on your own to strengthen this issue of faith in my capacity to practice.
Oh, okay. I have a question.
Yeah.
I would find it helpful to, if I want to focus on how to be joyous, I feel I need a guidance. It's very abstract. I can recollect times when I was happy or joyous, but I would like to be able to think about several things or many things, just as sometimes we do confession according to a list of things, then also I would like a kind of a very particular guidance on how to open my consciousness to happiness, because I feel it's not so, it doesn't come by so easily.
It's a big question. I don't think I can give you a particular guidance on this one. I think what we need to search for, I cannot give you a checklist. What I can maybe recommend is to find guiding books that inspire you to search within yourself according to what they say, and you can always check books that talk about joyous efforts. In the Lamrim, either you follow Lama Tsongkhapa or the series of Tobden Children and His Holiness about this topic, or Shantideva chapter 7. I would investigate chapters that are dealing with joyous efforts, and there are so many ideas there, and so many beautiful quotes, and so many examples that this inspire your path, where to search and how to practice according to their guidance. So I think this is the way I would do if I need to do this process on my own. Okay. I would like to read to you something that, you know, I felt, maybe I'll share the screen. I felt that Buddhism in Israel, they are posting some articles every once in a while, and sometimes it's exactly what we need. So I sent it to you, Alex, in English last night or the day before. And we are searching for ways to cultivate enthusiasm, faith of conviction that I can practice. So here's another direction that I was so touched and so inspired that I said this is the wonderful ending for such a topic. So I'll read in Hebrew, it's okay? So it's a commentary of Thich Nhat Hanh on the Lotus Sutra. It's a very famous Mahayana Sutra. And he calls it, Kol echad yechol liyot ve'yeh le'Buddha. Okay, as... בפרק 20, בספר סוטות הלוטוס מוצג בודיסטווה יפהפה ששמו סדה פארי בוטה. סדה פארי בוטה, שפירושו לעולם אינו מזלזל. אפשר לתרגם את שמו גם לעולם אינו בז. הבודיסטווה הזה לעולם אינו מזלזל ביצורים חיים, לעולם אינו ממעיט בערכם או מטיל ספק ביכולתם להיות בודה. המסר שלו הוא, אני יודע שיש לכם טבע בודה ושיש לכם את היכולת להיות בודה. וזהו בדיוק המסר של סוטרת הלוטוס. אתם כבר בודה במימד המוחלט, נכון? Ultimate Reality. ואתם יכולים להיות בודה גם במימד ההיסטורי. טבע הבודה, הטבע של התעוררות ואהבה, כבר קיים בכם. כל שעליכם לעשות הוא להתחבר אליו ולבטא אותו. כאילו המכשולים שלנו זה מה שמפריע מלהתחבר ולבטא. אם אתם יודעים את זה, אם אתם יכולים לראות את טבעכם האמיתי במימד המוחלט, תוכלו להגשים את טבע הבודה שבכם במימד ההיסטורי. הבודיסטווה שלעולם אינו מזלזל נמצא כדי להזכיר לנו את מהות טבענו האמיתי. הפעולה של הבודיסטווה הזה היא לשחרר בני אדם מרגשות של חוסר ערך והערכה עצמית נמוכה. איך אני יכול להפך לבודה? איך אני אוכל להגיע להתעוררות? אין בי שום דבר חוץ מסבל. אני לא יודע איך להשתחרר מהסבל שלי, ועל אחת כמה וכמה איך לעזור לאחרים. אני חסר ערך. בני אדם רבים מרגישים רגשות מסוג זה, המעמיקים את סבלם עוד יותר. הבודיסטווה שלעולם אינו בז, פועל כדי לעודד ולחזק את מי שמרגישים כך, להזכיר להם שיש להם טבע הבודה, שגם הם פלא החיים וגם הם יכולים להשיג את מה שהבודה משיג. זהו מסר עצום של תקווה ושל ביטחון. זהו תרגול של בודיסטווה במימד של הפעולה. סדה פארי בוטה היה למעשה שקיימוני באחד מגלגולי חייו הקודמים, כשבודה הופיע בעולם כבודיסטווה. אבל הבודה הזה לא דקלם את הסוטרות או תרגל בדרך הרגילה, הוא לא תרגל השתחוויות, הוא לא יצא למסעות עלייה לרגל, הוא לא ישב שעות ארוכות במדיטציה. לבודיסטווה שלעולם אינו בז הייתה מומחיות. בכל פעם שפגש אדם, הוא פנה אליו בכבוד רב ואמר, יש לך ערך. אתה בודה לעתיד, אני רואה את הפוטנציאל הזה בך. בסוטרת הלוטוס, עכשיו תקשיבו, זה קטע יפה. בסוטרת הלוטוס יש קטעים המלמדים שהמסר הזה לא תמיד יתקבל טוב. סוטרת אמיתיות, הן ריאליות, מאחר שרבים האנשים עדיין לא חשו חיבור עם המימד המוחלט. הם לא יכלו להאמין דברים שהבודיסטווה אמר להם על טבע הבודה. הטבוע בהם וחשבו שהוא לועג להם. לעתים קרובות הם לגלגו עליו, צעקו עליו וגירשו אותו. אבל אפילו כשלא האמינו לו וגירשו אותו בעלבונות ומכות, הוא שלעולם אינו בז לא כעס עליהם, או לא נטש אותם. מרחוק הוא המשיך לצעוק אליהם את האמת, אני לא בז לכם, אתם כולכם הולכים בדרך וכולכם תהיו לבודות. הבודיסטווה שלעולם אינו בז הוא ישר מאוד ויש בו שקט פנימי עמוק, הוא לעולם לא מתייאש מאיתנו. משמעות חייו, הגשמה של התרגול שלו, היא להביא את המסר הזה של ביטחון ושל תקווה לכולם. זהו המעשה של בודיסטווה גדול זה. עלינו ללמוד ולתרגל את המעשה הזה, אם אנחנו רוצים ללכת בדרך הבודיסטווה. אני אעצור כאן. יש את זה, you can find it in Buddhism in Israel, on Facebook or on their website, and the full article is there if you're interested. Gorgeous, no? Huh?
קצת כמו גם לתפקיד של מטפל.
שעוזר להכיר בזה.
כן.
Like a therapist, סיגל סז.
מקסים.
כן, and this is exactly what we are trying to do with the practice of realizing our own potential, having faith of conviction in our capacity to practice. Somebody wants to share something interesting from the discussion groups? You don't have to, just if there's some insight or something that you think everybody can benefit. So I think with these inspiring words we can dedicate and finish the session and finish the season. So we can do a big dedication. Ma.
No, לא, יש לנו משהו, אבל נעשה את זה, לא יתפזר, נעשה אחרי הקדשה.
אוקיי. So let's sit peacefully and comfortably. We'll do first the personal dedication and then we do the prayers together. Let's take a minute of just focusing on the breath and letting everything we discussed today to sink in. Take our time with that. We may think of all the merit we have accumulated today and during this whole year. Every practice, each time we remind ourselves of ethical discipline, every good motivation, every good intention, every aspiration to become a bodhisattva, every aspiration to take responsibility and support and help others. Each time we do these things, everything accumulates and leaves an imprint in our mind, and we accumulate merit. And this merit is a cause of happiness. And now we give this merit a direction, and we aspire and we pray that may this merit will ripen as a cause for happiness for each and every sentient being who need a cause for happiness. May all of our practice ripen into a capacity to fight our real enemies, the inside enemies of anger and attachment and aversion and hatred and impartiality and everything that now manifests in the world in such a harsh way, so much pain and suffering. And the real antidote for whatever happens outside is us cultivating our minds. Because from within comes peace and joy and love and equanimity. Only from within we can transform. So there's a lot of value for the group sessions and the Sangha meetings. So much value. And so much value to each and every session we do in our homes, alone, each one for himself. And the practice doesn't have to be on the cushion. It can be when we meet someone, when we look at someone with good eyes, kind eyes, bodhisattva eyes, that we help someone to feel more relaxed, to develop, to transform. So from our commitment to this path and for the happiness of others, we dedicate all of our merit. May this be serve as a cause to ripen as the future bodhicitta of each and every sentient being, for the future happiness of each and every sentient being, for peace around, for stopping the killing and the war and the suffering. And may all the merit we have accumulated together as a Sangha, we have a collective karma now. May this always serve as a cause to be born next to the path, next to a teacher, to have Dharma friends that will support us on the way so we can really continue with our practice for more and more cultivation. And we will not forget to rejoice along the way on each and every virtuous action we do, to keep ourselves enthusiastic. And we don't forget to support our friends, and we don't support, and we don't forget to see every Buddha nature potential in each and every living being. And we can dedicate our merit also for all of our teachers, for His Holiness the Dalai Lama, for all the heads of all the lineages, for Lama Zopa's swift return, for FPMT, who can now navigate this huge ship without his physical guidance. May all the wishes of all of our teachers be immediately fulfilled. May they have good health, and they will turn the wheel of Dharma for many more eons to come. And each one can do his own dedication. Thank you very much. Be good. Stay on the path. We'll continue to do many good things. From January, I'm back home. And until then, you have many teachers coming anyway. So I stop the recording now.
Toda raba.
Toda
lach Yael. Toda raba.
Toda raba.